الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله الذي أرسل بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا أما بعد قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم المهدي من عترتي من ولد فاطمة أو كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لو لم يبق من الدنيا إلا يوم لطول الله ذلك اليوم حتى يبعث رجلا مني أو من أهل بيتي يواطئ اسمه اسمي واسم أبيه اسم أبي وكما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم respected brothers, Alhamdulillah, the advertised topic has been talked about a lot in the recent past regards some people also saying that hopefully Hazrat Mahdi will arrive in 2004, where dates have been stipulated as well. But as we know from the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nothing can be prophesized or pinpointed with an exact date. Nothing. Maybe we have non-Muslims who have tried to do so. People like Nostradamus, I think if I remember rightly, last time I mentioned as well regards Nostradamus, who was born in the beginning of the 16th century, who was a French scientist, and he's mentioned many things regards the prophecies, where he has pinpointed dates as well, where he has mentioned that Armageddon will take place in 1998 in June or July, etc., etc. So in Islam, we do not have a pinpoint accuracy where this will happen on this day and this will happen on this day. All we do know is that there are a sequence of events that will happen before the end of time. Hazrat Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahmatullahi alayh, has mentioned on the authority of Sayyidina Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, his student Abu Nudra, rahmatullahi alayhi, mentions that Sayyidina Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood up to give a lecture after the afternoon prayer, i.e. the late afternoon prayer, which is Asr. And he gave a lecture, and in that lecture he mentioned what was to take place and what will transpire before the end of time. Then he says, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says, from the things that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, the ones that remembered what he mentioned, they remembered. And the ones that forgot, they forgot. But in that hadith, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned everything that was to happen, the main events that were to happen till the day of Qiyamah. At the end of that hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, pointing to the sun is about to set. What is left of this day compared to the amount of time that has passed in the day is the same comparison to what has gone from the world compared to what is left. Meaning we are going through the end of time. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying this 1400 years ago. Okay, the sun is about to go down. The portion that you have left for the remainder of the day compared to the day that has already gone. This is the comparison from the time that we have already seen the world go, and now that is the time that is left. Meaning a very small amount of portion, a very, very small portion is left. This is why we find in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah said, أَنَا وَالسَّاعَةُ كَهَاتَيْنِ. Me and Qiyama are like this. And Allama Idris Kandalvi, rahmatullahi alayhi, said the index finger of Rasulullah and the middle finger of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were of the same size. He has mentioned in Siratul Mustafa that the two fingers of Rasulullah, the index and the middle finger, were of the same size. Because Rasulullah normally used to use him as an example with the index finger. And obviously no one's bigger than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we know we are going through the end of time. Hazrat Mahdi is also one of the final signs towards the end of time. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned towards the end of time, this will happen, this will happen. I'll just very, very briefly like to mention 3-4 minor signs, and then inshallah we will start with the actual topic of Hazrat Mahdi. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi, and the reason why I'm mentioning these signs, so that it opens our eyes regards the truth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, there will come a time before the end of time, يَسْتَغْنِ الرِّجَالِ بِالرِّجَالِ وَالنِّسَاءِ بِالنِّسَاءِ. The men will fulfill their desires with men and women with women. نِكَاحُ الرَّجُلِ بِالرَّجُلِ وَالْمَرْأَةِ بِالْمَرْأَةِ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, man, the man will marry the man and the lady will marry the lady. And we know in this country, 21st, 22nd, and 23rd of December, these 30 days, when in this country, in Wales, Scotland, and England, the marriage was legalized in this country. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prophesied there will come that time where this will happen. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned, and these are the signs that we are seeing materializing in front of our own eyes. Rasulullah said, Adna ar-rajul. صَدِيقَهُ وَأَقَصَى أَبَاهُ. A person will near his friend and he will distance himself away from his father, from his parents. This is also one of the signs of Qiyamah. And obviously many, many others, but one of the major signs, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi, in fact one of the first major signs, Rasulullah mentioned that will come, that will be apparent and the people will see, will be the arrival of Hazrat Mahdi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. A lot of people say Hazrat Imam Mahdi. The scholars of South Africa, especially Hazrat Maulana from Azadville, Maulana Azmi from Azadville, he is of the opinion that Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah should not use the word Imam Mahdi. They should use the word Hazrat Mahdi. Because obviously he's trying to gear the Muslims away from another sect from amongst the Muslims. That a person should say Hazrat Mahdi and not Imam Mahdi. Anyway, Hazrat Mahdi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu is one of the first major signs Rasulullah has prophesied in this ummah. Now, we find many, many ahadith that have been mentioned regards Hazrat Mahdi. Imam al-Shawkani rahmatullahi alayhi has mentioned in his kitab At-Tawdih Al-Ahadith Anil Mahdi Mutawatira. The ahadith that have been mentioned regards Hazrat Mahdi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu in the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are many. Yes, we know and we have to admit ourselves there are many, many ahadith that are weak. There are also many ahadith that are sahih and hasan. There might be some ahadith as well that have been fabricated as well regards Hazrat Mahdi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. But inshallah, there are many, many ahadith mentioned regards the reality and the truth of Hazrat Mahdi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. But what we do know from the entire compilation of the ahadith regards Hazrat Mahdi, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that Hazrat Mahdi will come into this world at a time where there will be chaos, there will be corruption, there will be disruption, there will be civil war, and all this will intensify to such an extent that the people who are living, when they will go past a grave, when they will go past a grave and know someone who has passed away in front of their own eyes, that person will say, Ya laytani kuntu makana. Had it been so that I was in your place, and you would have been alive walking on the surface of the earth. This is how hard the times will become. And we know the times that we are living in at the moment are so, so hard. We know the times that we are living in, especially when we go to those areas. See, in this country, we do not realize. Because we do not witness these things on us, upon ourselves. We do not experience it upon ourselves. But when it comes to those people who are seeing their very, very close brethren and their family members being martyred, then only a person will realize the chaos and the disruption and the civil war the people are going through. Anyway, this is what we find regards what Rasulullah mentioned regards Hazrat Mahdi. Now, we need to look at the stance of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Basically, there are three opinions when it comes to believing in Hazrat Mahdi. There are three opinions. Opinion number one is Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. the group Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned will be the successful ones. The Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah are of the opinion that Hazrat Mahdi and Hazrat Isa are both separate personalities. They will come individually in their own time. We believe in the descension of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and we also believe in the arrival of Hazrat Mahdi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. We do not believe that Isa and Mahdi are one personality. This is very, very important. We need to understand this. So we have to believe they are both two personalities. Hazrat Mahdi will come and he will be one of the final signs of Qiyamah. This is a stance of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Then we have a second stance, where you have the people who completely reject the personality of Hazrat Mahdi. They say, because all the ahadith that are mentioned regards Hazrat Mahdi are all weak, or maybe they are fabricated as well, therefore we do not believe in the personality of Mahdi. And they reject all the ahadith that are mentioned regards Hazrat Mahdi. Now, in this group we have some people like Abdullah bin Zayd, we have people like Muhammad Rashid, then we have people like there's one person, inna lillah. There are many people who fall in this category who have denied all the ahadith. Then along with them, we have also those people who have claimed themselves that they were Mahdi. We have had those people as well who have claimed they were Mahdi. Example, we have a very simple example of Muhammad bin Tomer. Okay, in the history of Islam, you will find everything. You know, Muslims have been always, you know, right at the forefront in every field. It'll be anything, the Muslims will be there. Muhammad bin Tomer, he was a Muslim. He claimed he was a Mahdi. Ubaydullah ibn Maymun, okay, he claimed he was a Mahdi as well. His grandfather was a Jew. So obviously, we know where he came from. So Ubaydullah ibn Maymun. Then we have other people as well. Example, Ghulam Ahmed Qadiani, who he claimed as well that he was the Mahdi, the promised Mahdi. So now we have those people who completely reject Mahdi, and we have those people who themselves have claimed that they are the Mahdi. And then we have the third stance. And the third opinion is regards a sect from amongst the Muslims. We have a sect and a group amongst the Muslims. What do they say? They believe in the Mahdi, but they do not believe in the Mahdi in which the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah believe. They believe in another Mahdi. And obviously the brothers will know where I am coming from. The Shias, they believe that every imam that came, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they say promised to 12 imams. And they believe only the son of the imam will succeed his father to become an imam. Example, Hazrat Ali radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, they believe in as the first imam. Acha, who will be the imam after him? Obviously, one of his sons. Imam Hassan, Imam Hussein. So it was Imam Hassan. So what they believe, after the 11th imam, his name was Hassan al-Askari. Hassan al-Askari. He did not have two children. Now they had to make a 12th imam. They had to make a 12th imam. So now they believe 4 to 5 years before Hassan al-Askari passed away, his wife gave birth and he was an invisible child. And this is mentioned in Usul al-Kafi. This is mentioned in Usul al-Kafi, one of the main reference books of the Shishias. It is believed that he had a child and basically he became invisible. Approximately 10 days before his father passed away, Hassan al-Askari, 10 days before he passed away, Muhammad bin Hassan al-Askari, who they believe as the final imam, as Hazrat Mahdi, he went into a cave with the Quran. At the age of 5, he basically secluded himself. He went into a cave, he concealed himself, and obviously he was never exposed. And before the end of time, he will come and he will expose himself, and he is the promised Mahdi that is to come. Now you have these three groups. The Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we have in between, we have that group who reject all the ahadith, and therefore if you reject all the ahadith, there is no Mahdi. And the third one, they believe in the Mahdi, but not the Mahdi that we believe in as Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Now in order to combat these three opinions, we need to realize, we have to answer the critics and the people who claim that they were Mahdi. Example, let's take the opinion of those who reject Hazrat Mahdi in totality. The people who do not believe that there is a Mahdi. What do these people say? They have two to three arguments. Argument number one, they say every hadith that has been mentioned regards Hazrat Mahdi, every hadith is weak or is fabricated. Number one. Number two, there is no hadith regards Hazrat Mahdi in Bukhari and Muslim. Therefore, we will not accept the personality of Mahdi. That's number two. And number three, they say there's one hadith quoted by Hazrat Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala, mentioned by Sunan ibn Majah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, La Isa, la Mahdi illa Isa ibn Maryam. There is no Mahdi but Isa ibn Maryam. So there's only one Mahdi, and that Mahdi is Isa ibn Maryam. So now, because of these arguments, obviously we have to reply. Now, the first question is that they reject every hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regards Hazrat Mahdi. They say every hadith is weak or is fabricated. Now, in order to combat that, we have to realize this is absolutely false. There are many, many ahadith that have been mentioned by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Example I've mentioned in the beginning, Imam al-Shawkani rahmatullahi alayhi says, Al-ahadith anil Mahdi mutawatira. The ahadith regards Imam Mahdi are mutawatir. Are numerous. Now, there's one hadith quoted by Imam Hakim rahmatullahi alayhi in his mustadrak. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Yasqi Allahu al-ghayth, yakhruju fi akhiri ummati al-Mahdi. Towards the end of time in my ummah, there will come the Mahdi. Yasqi Allahu al-ghayth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send for him abundance of rain. وَتَخْرُجُ الْأَرْضُ نَبَاتَهَا. And the earth will send out its crop. وَيَقْسِمُ الْمَالَ صِحَاهَا. And he will distribute wealth equally. And then Rasulullah says, and he will rule in the world, and he will fill the world with justice. And he will stay alive for 7 years, in one hadith for 8 years, in one hadith for 9 years. So now that hadith, Imam Hakim rahmatullahi has quoted, it has been mentioned that this is a hadith sahihul isnad. This is a hadith, and the transmission of the hadith is absolutely fine. Imam Hakim rahmatullahi has mentioned the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regards as al-Mahdi, and that hadith as well is absolutely fine. There's a hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala that is mentioned by Imam al-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَوْ لَمْ يَبْقَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا يَوْمٌ. If there was only one day left for the world to come to an end and for the world to perish, there's only one day left. لَطَوَّلَ اللَّهُ ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will prolong that day to such an extent, حَتَّى يَبْعَثَ رَجُلًا مِّنِّي, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send a person from me, أو مِنْ أَهْلِ بَيْتِي, or from my family. Then Rasulullah continued and he says, he will rule on the earth, فَيَمْلَأُ الْأَرْضَ قِسْطًا وَعَدْلًا. He will fill the entire world with justice. This is what Rasulullah has mentioned. Imam al-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi has mentioned this hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and then at the end of the hadith, Imam al-Tirmidhi has a habit of commenting on the hadith. He says, هَذَا حَدِيثٌ حَسَنٌ صَحِيحٌ. This is a hasan and a sahih hadith. So those people who said they are all fabricated or weak ahadith, this is wrong. Because we know there are ahadith that are sound and they are sahih and they are hasan. So that is the number one. This is what a person has to realize. Okay, there are ahadith that are strong ahadith. The second argument, so this is one argument number one. The second argument for these people was, okay, there is no hadith in Bukhari and Muslim regards Hazrat Mahdi. Therefore, we reject the personality of Mahdi. Now, this in itself is absolutely stubbornness. This is nothing but stubbornness. Why? Because we find Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi has a compilation of 6,000 ahadith. He himself says that those 6,000 ahadith that I have mentioned in Bukhari was a compilation or taken from a compilation of 400,000 ahadith. So Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi had 400,000 sahih ahadith, from which he has only taken 6,000. So where are the 394,000 that he has not took? So a hadith that is not in Bukhari and Muslim does not mean, okay, it is not sahih. That is one thing. Another thing is Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi, himself says, لم أخرج في هذا الكتاب إلا ما صح وما تركت من الصحيح أكثر. Yes, I have only taken sahih ahadith in my kitab, but what I have left out is much more than what I have included in my kitab. So according to the statement of Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi himself, Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi says many sahih ahadith he has not taken in his kitab. Another thing, Imam Hafiz ibn Kathir rahmatullahi has mentioned, كَإِنَّ بُخَارِي وَمُسْلِمْ لَمْ يَلْتَزِمَا بِإِخْرَاجِ جَمِيعِ مَا يَصِحُ عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ. Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim have not took it upon themselves to mention every single hadith that is sahih in their compilation. You know, they can't do that. There are so many sahih ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You cannot encompass all these ahadith in one kitab. This is one thing. And another thing, some scholars are of the opinion that there is one hadith quoted by Imam Muslim on the authority of Jabir ibn Abdullah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned, there will come a time towards the end of time, la tazalu ta'ifatun min ummati yuqatiluna ala al-haq zahirina ila yawm al-qiyamah. Okay, there will always be one group in my ummah who will always fight for the right cause, for the haqq. And they will always remain, they will always overpower everyone till the day of Qiyamah. That will always happen. And then Rasulullah says, until that time will come. فَيَنْزِلُ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمْ. Isa ibn Maryam will come down. He will descend. And then, what does he say? The Amir of the Muslims will say to Isa, تَعَالْ صَلِّ لَنَا. Come and perform salah for us. So who is that Amir of the Muslims when Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will come down? Obviously that will be Hazrat Mahdi. That will be Hazrat Mahdi. So although the name of Hazrat Mahdi is not clearly stated in the hadith of Imam Muslim, but obviously that it is a reference to Hazrat Mahdi. So anyway, that is the argument of those people who say that there is no hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. Now as to the hadith of Anas ibn Malik, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, La Mahdi illa Isa ibn Maryam. There is no Mahdi but Isa ibn Maryam. This is a hadith quoted by Ibn Majah. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned this hadith. Allama ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi has stated, this hadith is absolutely weak in transmission because of Muhammad ibn Khalid al-Jundi. And he was very, very weak. And even, let's take the hadith and let's say the hadith is sound. For a moment, let's say the hadith is sound. Okay, there is no Mahdi but Isa ibn Maryam. Then we can say, La Mahdi kamilan ma'suman illa Isa ibn Maryam. There is no kamil and complete Mahdi but Isa. Because the only person who is ma'sum and free from sin is a Nabi. Hazan Mahdi was not ma'sum because he was not a Nabi. Only Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam are ma'sum. Ma'sum means they are free from sin. So that was obviously the Mukammal Mahdi is Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. This is what the hadith is stating. The person who was truly guided, who was absolutely Mukammal and he was Kamil, he was complete and he was free from sin. That is Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. So anyway, that is for them. Now, let's take the argument of those people themselves who claimed they were Mahdi. Example, we have Ghulam Ahmed Qadiani. We have Muhammad bin Tomer. We have Ubaidullah ibn Maymun. In order to understand or in order to refute the claim of these people who claimed they were Mahdis themselves, we need to understand the personality of Hazrat Mahdi. We need to understand the time in which Hazrat Mahdi will come. We need to understand what events will take place in the time of Hazrat Mahdi. Let's take first the personality of Hazrat Mahdi radiyallahu ta'ala. What will he look like? What was his name? Etc. etc. From the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then every single person who claimed to be a Nabi, we can fit all the ahadith of Rasulullah on those claimants of Mahdi. So example, let's take the first hadith. The hadith of Hazrat Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, mentioned by Imam al-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I've just mentioned the hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if there was only one day left for the world to come to an end, there's only one day left, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will prolong that day to such an extent. So much so. Okay, Hazrat Mahdi will come. He will rule. His rule will last for 7 years. And justice will prevail. And thereafter he will die. And then obviously all the rest of the matters that are to come, they will come as well. But that will be such a long day. What Rasulullah is mentioning, okay, Hazrat Mahdi coming into this world is an absolute must. He has to come. At the end of that hadith, what does Hazrat Rasulullah say? His name will be the same as my name, and his father's name will be the same as my father's name. So Hazrat Mahdi will be called Muhammad bin Abdullah. Now that is the first thing. This is a hadith quoted by Imam al-Tirmidhi. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud has mentioned it. Now, Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani. What was his name? His name was Ahmed. Hazrat Mahdi's name is Muhammad. All the other claimants as well. In fact, you know, approximately 32 years ago in Manchester, not long ago, no, sorry, I think somewhere around the mid-1980s, there was one person in Manchester who claimed to be Mahdi, in Manchester. The theatre of dreams. So basically he was really dreaming. Yeah, so he claimed that he was a Mahdi. He claimed that he was a Mahdi. Now, wallahu alam, I do not know what his name was, but we got Muhammad ibn Tomar, Ubaidullah ibn Maymun, we got Qadiani, Ghulam Ahmed Qadiani. Now obviously these people were not the same what Rasulullah has mentioned in his hadith. So that's number one. Number two, the hadith of Salama radiyallahu ta'ala, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She says, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Mahdi min itrati min wuldi Fatima. Hazrat Mahdi will be from my progeny, from my family, from the children of Hazrat Fatima radiyallahu ta'ala anha. From his father's side, Hazrat Mahdi, from his father's side, he will be a Hassani. And from his mother's side, he will be a Husayni. So Hassani and Husayni. Now we know those people who have claimed were not from the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is obviously the second argument. Then if you come along, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned many, many other features of Hazrat Mahdi that basically refutes the claim of every other claimant of Mahdism. Every single other person. Example, let's take the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, okay, Hazrat Mahdi will be born where? He will come from Medina Munawwara. He will come from Medina Munawwara. All the other claimants of Nubuwa, Mahdi, not one of them was from Medina Munawwara. Then regards Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned many, many other facial appearances and physical appearances of Hazrat Mahdi. Example, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned Hazrat Mahdi will have a slight stutter in his tongue, because of which he will become frustrated, due to which he will strike his right hand on his left thigh. You know, out of frustration, this is what he will do. And then Rasulullah mentioned, Hazrat Mahdi fi lisanihi thiqlud. He will have a bojh and a burden on his tongue. I.e. obviously he will have a start. He will have a slight start. Then Rasulullah has mentioned that Hazrat Mahdi will have a spot. He will have a spot on his cheek. He will have a black spot on his cheek. If I remember rightly, it will be on his right cheek. Rasulullah has mentioned in regards, this hadith has been mentioned by Imam al-Tabarani, rahmatullahi alayhi. Rasulullah has mentioned he will be tall. He will be tall. He will be fair in complexion. He will have a bright forehead, broad and bright forehead. He will have a high bridge nose. He will have a high bridge nose. And Rasulullah has mentioned many, many features. And then Rasulullah has said, يَشْبَهُهُ فِي الْخُلْقِ. His character, the character of Hazrat Mahdi, will be the same as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, obviously these are the basic physical appearances of Hazrat Mahdi. He will be tall. He will be tall as well. I'm not too sure regards Ghulam Qadiani and the other people who have claimed what their size was. But obviously they will not be too big on the day of Qiyam. So, these are the physical features and the name, etc. of Hazrat Mahdi. Now, the time in which Hazrat Mahdi will come, very, very briefly, I'll mention that as well. And that also rules out all the other people as well. There's 5 or 6 things to remember before the emergence of Hazrat Mahdi. And inshallah, you know, this is something that we need to look out for, because I guarantee you, the arrival of Hazrat Mahdi is not far, far away. The time is going so fast. The time is materializing so fast, it is going so fast. Events are changing so fast. And inshallah, as we go along, I'll just mention what the Christians will do towards the end of time. And we know everything is gearing towards that time. Inshallah, I'll mention it towards the end. But the time before which Hazrat Mahdi will come into this world, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned 5 to 6 things. Okay, this will be the time when a person should realize now it is a time for Hazrat Mahdi to appear. Number one, Rasulullah has mentioned it will be a time of chaos, corruption, civil war, disruption, to such an extent that people will wish for death. People will want to die. People will be wanting to be in the graves and not walking on the surface of the earth. That's number one. And we know at the moment some people, some places around the world are going through or passing through that phase. That's number one. Number two, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned, before the emergence of Hazrat Mahdi, there will be an eclipse in the month of Ramadan. On the first of Ramadan, there will be the eclipse of the moon. And on the mid, the 15th of Ramadan, لِلنِّسْفِ مِنْ Ramadan, there will be the eclipse of the sun. Now this hadith had been mentioned by Imam al-Dari Qutni, rahmatullahi alayhi. But I would very, very clearly like to mention, the only reason why I've mentioned this hadith, because a lot of people mention this hadith. But the scholars have gone into this hadith, they have done a research on this hadith, and they have mentioned they are in the chain of narration, there are approximately one or two places where the chain of narration has some Shias inside. And this is why some scholars are of the opinion that this hadith is absolutely fabricated. Although it has been mentioned in Imam Dari Qutni's kitab, Dari Qutni. But even then the scholars have mentioned that the hadith of the eclipse of the moon and the sun in one month during the month of Ramadan is a fabricated hadith. So that is number two. But obviously you can discount that. Number three, the river Euphrates. The river Euphrates, this is one of the signs of just before Hazrat Mahdi. The river Euphrates will send out heaps of gold. It's a hadith of Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mentioned, if I remember rightly, is mentioned by Imam Hakim rahmatullahi alayhi, لا تقوم الساعة. Qiyamah will not come حتى يحسو فرات جيلا من ذهب. Until the river Euphrates will send out heaps of gold. فيقتتل عليه رجال من الناس. People will fight over it. فيقتل من كل مئة تسعة وتسعون. Out of every 100 people that will go for this gold, 99 will be killed. And Rasulullah says, فَمَنْ حَضَرَ فَلَا يَأْخُذُ مِنْهُ شَيْئًا. A person who is present at the time should not take anything from the gold, because there is no point. It is not worth it. Because a person will lose his life. So this, the sending of river Euphrates, sending out heaps of gold. River Euphrates, we know where the river Euphrates is. A lot of people did not know, but now due to the invasion of Iraq, now we all know where the river Euphrates is. It's towards the area of Iraq and Syria. It's in between. We call it in Arabic Dajla-e-Furat. Dajla'e for Furat. That this will send out heaps of gold. Now that can be black gold in the form of oil. Wallahu a'lam. Allah Ta'ala knows best. If that is the case, we know that is happening. You know, you will be shocked to hear the figures. Since the time that America has invaded Iraq, the latest survey that was carried out in December, they are saying approximately 23 people on average have been killed per day. Since the time they invaded in 2003 till 2005 end, they're saying approximately on average 23 people have died. 23 to 30 people on average per day are dying. And this also explains the hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said there will come a time before the end of time, okay, one man will look after 50 women of his family. حتى يكون الرجل الواحد قيما لخمسين امرأة. Rasulullah said there will be one man who will be the guardian of 50 women in his family. And we know why that happens, because in the battle normally the men perish. So there will only be the women left. And this is also everything gearing towards the end of time. So that is the second one, or you can take it the third one. Okay, the river Euphrates will send out heaps of gold. Number three, the sign before the arrival of Hazrat Mahdi. Hazrat Amr ibn Shu'ayb, rahmatullahi alayhi, has mentioned, okay, tribes will gather in the month of Dhul Qa'dah. You know, Dhul Qa'dah and Dhul Hijjah. In the month of Dhul Qa'dah, the tribes will gather around the Haram. And that same year, during the time of Hajj, there will be civil war in Mina. During the days of Hajj, there will be civil war in Mina. And this will cause a bloodshed due to the civil war. Obviously, there will be a lot of bloodshed. And there will be streams of blood flowing, Muslim blood, in Mina because of internal fighting. And then people will make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the arrival of the Mahdi. That's number three. Number four, the emergence of the Sufyani. A person will come out. He will be from the progeny and the family of Hazrat Abu Sufyan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. His name will be Urwa ibn Muhammad. Urwa ibn Muhammad. He will come out from Sham, from Damascus, from the depth of Damascus. He will come out. He will have no mercy at all. He will cut the chest of women. He will kill two children. He will kill children, and especially he will kill the Sayyids, the people who have a connection with the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he will cause absolute chaos in Syria, Damascus. That is also one of the signs prior to the arrival of Hazrat Mahdi. And the last one Rasulullah has mentioned, there will be one entire village in Syria will be absolutely swallowed into the earth. The swallowing of the village in Sham, as mentioned in the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So these are the signs prior to the arrival of Hazrat Mahdi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Now, what will happen actually in the time of Hazrat Mahdi? Just before the emergence of Hazrat Mahdi, what will happen? There will be one Muslim ruler who will fight with the Nasara. Some words I have difficulty saying. He will fight with the Nasara, he will fight with the Christians. Now, in that fight, the Muslim ruler will lose. The Christians will be victorious. One portion of the Christian army, the Muslims will sign a peace treaty with them. So with one, see, the Christian army will divide into two. One army from the Christians will go and they will conquer Turkey. They will conquer Istanbul. Now, the other group from the Christians and the Muslims who have signed a peace treaty among themselves, they will fight with that Christian army. And the Muslim army and the half-Christian army, they will defeat that other Christian army who have conquered Turkey. Now, obviously, it becomes one party. The Muslims and the remainder of the Christians, with whom the Muslims have a peace treaty, they become one party. Now, after a few days, one Christian person will stand up and say, "We were given victory in Turkey, Istanbul, because of the cross." Because of the cross. A Muslim will stand up and say, "No, it was because of Islam." And now this will cause a fight amongst the Muslims and the Christians with whom the Muslims were at a peace treaty. And now what will happen? The Muslims will be defeated. The ruler of the Muslim army will be martyred. The ruler of the Muslim army will be martyred. The remainder of the Muslim party will come towards Madinah Munawwara in search for the leader, in anticipation for the Mahdi. Now, those two Christian groups will get back together and they will go and they will attack Syria and they will conquer Syria. This will be at the time that is mentioned by Umm Salama radiyallahu ta'ala anha in the hadith. Okay, there will come a time in Medina Munawwara when the leader of the Muslims in Medina Munawwara will die. And the people will be in anticipation who they can make as a leader. So Hazrat Mahdi radiyallahu ta'ala will run away from Medina Munawwara and he will go to Makkah Mukarrama. Why? In fear, people will make me the leader. And he does not want to become the leader. Now the people are in anticipation in Makkah, in Medina, everywhere for the Mahdi. And Hazrat Mahdi radiyallahu ta'ala would have traveled from Makkah to Medina. And from Medina to Makkah. And Hazrat Mahdi will be recognized, Rasulullah says, بَيْنَ الرُّكْنِ وَالْمَقَامِ, between Rukne Jamani and the Maqam Ibrahim. Between that area, he will be recognized. And when that will happen, in the meantime, Sufyani has heard of the emergence of the Mahdi. The Sufyani who is in Sham, he has heard regards the emergence of Hazrat Mahdi. Sufyani will send an army to attack Hazrat Mahdi. And that army of the Sufyani who will come from Sham, Hazrat Mahdi radiallahu ta'ala at the time will be in Makkah Mukarramah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will destroy that entire army. In between Makkah and Medina, at an area called Bayda. It's mentioned in the hadith, فَيُخْسَفُ بِهِمْ بِالْبَيْدَى. The entire army will be swallowed into the earth. فَلَا يَنْجُوا إِلَّا مُخْبِرٌ. Rasulullah says, there'll only be one person who will be saved. And that will be the person who will bring back the news to Syria that the entire army has perished and has been swallowed and taken into the earth. So this will happen. Now, Hazrat Mahdi will be recognized, due to which the Abdal of Sham, the very, very pious people in the Abdal of Sham, they will travel from Sham, and some people from Iraq as well, they will come, and they will come to Makkah Mukarramah. And they will be, Rasulullah says, كَعِدَّةِ أَهْلِ بَدْرِ. The amount of people that participated in the Battle of Badr, 313 people will swear allegiance on the hands of Hazrat Mahdi. And they will say, basically, we will fight in the army of Hazrat Mahdi. Now, as soon as Hazrat Mahdi is made the leader of the Muslims, Hazrat Mahdi will travel from Makkah Mukarramah to Medina Munawwara. He will come to the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He will basically recite durood, etc. there. And then Hazrat Mahdi will send an army. Sorry, he will go from there to Syria. They will go from there to Syria. They'll have Muslims will have a large army, a huge army. They will go to Syria, because Syria is in the control of the Christians. So they will go there. Now, one third of the party of Hazrat Mahdi will disperse and basically flee, seeing the army of the Christians in Sham. Rasulullah says, these are the worst of the creation of Allah. Those people who participated in the army of Hazrat Mahdi and will flee before the battle. One third will do that. One third will be martyred in Sham against the Christians. And one third will be victorious. And this will happen. And basically this will be the... Thereafter Hazrat Mahdi will also send an army of 70,000 people to Istanbul. To Istanbul. And the Muslims will conquer Istanbul and Turkey without a fight. They will go there, they will approach the huge wall, and they will say Allahu Akbar, and the entire wall will come down. The entire wall will come down. And obviously this will be the rule of Hazrat Mahdi. Now, we find in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhumah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, okay, how will that ummah perish? How will that ummah be defeated? At the beginning of which is Muhammad, at the end of which is Isa ibn Maryam, and in between will be Muhammad ibn Abdullah, a Mahdi. So basically, inshallah, this is a reference towards the arrival of Hazrat Mahdi. Then inshallah, there will come a time where there will be absolute justice. Hazrat Mahdi will lead a normal life. He will stay in this world for approximately 7 years. There are three different narrations, 7 years, 8 years, or 9 years. But the most authentic is 7 years. Hazrat Mahdi will stay in this world for 7 years, and the time will be so, so peaceful, and there will be so much justice. Okay, the people, when they will go past graves, they will think, okay, kash, you people would have been alive, so you would have also enjoyed the peace of this time. And then obviously Hazrat Mahdi will anticipate the arrival of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and then obviously they will anticipate Dajjal, and they will fight against the Dajjal, and they will defeat the Dajjal. So this will be the arrival of Hazrat Mahdi. This will be, wallahu alam, Allah Ta'ala alone knows the time in which Hazrat Mahdi will come. But it is part of our aqeedah that we must believe in the promised Mahdi, and we must believe Hazrat Mahdi and Isa are two different personalities. Because the Qadianis are trying to force everyone to think that Isa and Mahdi is the same personality. Because Qadiani believed, until 1879, he was an absolute normal person. He was born in 1839. 1879, until the age of 40, he was absolutely fine. And thereafter, basically, he stood up as a reformer. And then obviously he started, he's a reformer, and then he said he was a Mahdi, then he said he was Isa, then he said he's a prophet, and then he said he's a final prophet, etc., etc. Many, many different claims. So he was Muhammad as well, the last prophet, he was Isa as well, that is to come down, and then he said, I am a replica of Isa, and then he said, I am Mahdi as well. So anyway, we know our aqeedah is there are two different personalities. We must believe in that. We do not have to know the time that he will come. What we have to realize and know is, are we in anticipation of Hazrat Mahdi? Okay, when he comes, we can inshallah join his army. We can join his army and we can sacrifice ourselves for the sake of Islam. Are we ready to do that? We do not have to know. Okay, you know, a lot of people say, okay, inshallah, there's still a long time. We will never see the time of Hazrat Mahdi. We'll never see the time of Dajjal, etc., etc. We do not. That is not what we have to realize. What we have to realize is, are we prepared? And because remember, every person's qiyamah is separate. Rasulullah has mentioned in the hadith, man mata faqad qamat qiyamatuhu. A person who dies, his qiyamah has started. So as soon as a person dies, our qiyamah has started. So we do not have to think a qiyamah is a long way away. We do not know. As Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam asked his children, okay, what is the nearest thing to a human being? What thing is the nearest to the human being? Only Sulaiman alayhi salam replied. Sulaiman alayhi salam said, the nearest thing to the human being is his death. And you know, death, maut. In Arabic we say maut. You turn around the word maut and it's taum, ta wa mim. And the word taum in the Arabic language means a twin. So life and death are twins. They come together and they go together. A person comes into this world, not only he brings life with him, but he brings death with him as well. And that death follows him wherever he goes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the true understanding of the Mahdi that is to come. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to prepare before the time of the arrival of the Mahdi. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.